Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. In this video, we will discuss the closed loop frequency response from chapter 7 of your textbook. One of the important problems in analyzing a control system is to find all the closed loop poles, or at least those poles which are close to the J omega axis, which are called the dominant pair of the closed loop poles. Why we are interested to find out these poles? Because the stability of the system depends upon the position of the poles. And if they are close to the J omega axis with a slight change in the gain in the loop of your system can cause the instability. So the position of the closed loop poles which are close to the J omega axis is an important information, because with the help of that we can determine and look at the stability of the system. If the open loop frequency response characteristics of a system are known, so it may be possible to estimate the closed loop poles closest to the J omega axis. Okay, for a stable system, unity feedback closed loop system, the closed loop frequency response can be obtained easily from that of the open loop frequency response. Consider the unity feedback system that is shown in this figure. Here you can see the unity feedback, and its transfer function, closed loop transfer function, is given by this equation, where GS is the open loop transfer function or the transfer function of your plant. So the closed loop transfer function for this loop is given by this equation. Now let's look at the closed loop frequency response. So the polar plot of the transfer function G of S is, let's suppose, is given by this figure. When you are going to change the frequency omega, the magnitude and the phase of your transfer function G of S is changing. And let's suppose it is changing like this. So you can evaluate the magnitude of the transfer function at any frequency. Let's suppose that at frequency omega 1 at this point A, you are evaluating your transfer function G of S. So its magnitude will be equal to OA, that is the length of this vector, and the phase of your transfer function will be equal to this phi. So you can evaluate the transfer function at any frequency. For one particular frequency omega 1, this diagram is shown in front of you. Okay, now let's talk about the critical point, this minus 1 plus 0 j point. We have discussed the importance of this point in the previous videos, that how it plays an important role in determining the stability of the system. So over here, if you look at this part, the magnitude of this vector from this 0 to this critical point OP will be equal to 1. We know that the magnitude of this part can be evaluated by replacing omega with omega 1 in the system transfer function. So if you know the length of this vector, so you can find out this vector PA, the length of this vector. And if you evaluate this one, so the vector PA, that is the vector from minus 1 plus 0 point to the Nyquist locus, represents 1 plus g of j omega 1, right? So this vector is representing 1 plus g j omega 1. Okay, so therefore the ratio of this vector OA, this one, that is the magnitude of the transfer function at omega 1, the ratio of this one to this vector PA will give us the closed loop frequency response. Why? Because we know that for a unity feedback system, the closed loop transfer function is this one, G of S divided by 1 plus G of S, as we have seen in the previous slide. So we are replacing S with J omega. So what is this one? G of j omega. G of j omega is this vector, right? And this vector is 1 plus g of j omega. So if we evaluate this g of j omega at frequency omega 1, the closed loop response of the system can be determined, where g of j omega is the open loop transfer function. If you have the unity feedback system, it's easier to determine the closed loop response, because just you will have to solve your transfer function for the frequency omega 1, and then taking the ratio of g omega 1 with 1 plus g of j omega 1, you will get the response, closed loop response of your system. So for the unity feedback system, we can easily determine the closed loop response by looking at the open loop response, right? Okay, now let's go through this slide. The magnitude of the closed loop transfer function at omega is equal to omega 1 is the ratio of the magnitude of the vector OA and the vector PA that we discussed earlier. And the phase of the closed loop transfer function at omega is equal to omega 1 is the angle formed by OA to the PA. This is OA and this is PA. So this angle, this is phi minus theta. This is the angle phi. That's the phase of your open loop transfer function, g of j omega, evaluated at omega 1. And the phase of this vector, 1 plus g of j omega, is theta. So in the numerator, we have g of j omega 1. And in the denominator, we have 1 plus g of j omega 1. So this angle, that is phi minus theta, will be the angle that is the phase of your closed loop response. So the phase of the closed loop transfer function at omega is equal to omega 1 is the angle that is formed by these two lines, OA and the PA. So by measuring the magnitude and phase angle at different frequencies, the closed loop frequency response curve can be obtained. Now let us define the magnitude of the closed loop frequency response as m and the phase angle as alpha. So we can represent our closed loop transfer function like this, that is c of j omega divided by r of j omega, that is equal to the magnitude into e j alpha. Okay, so it means it is a complex number. Definitely it's a complex number, because you can see the j omega over here. So for the complex number, you can find out the magnitude with the help of this equation x plus iota y or j y. The magnitude will be equal to x square plus y square under root, and the angle can be determined with the help of this equation. And definitely it will be representing a circle. Okay, now after defining the magnitude of the closed loop response as m and the phase angle as alpha, from the above equation we can find the constant magnitude loci and the constant phase angle loci. So such loci are convenient in determining the closed loop frequency response from the polar plot or Nyquist plot. To obtain the constant magnitude loci, let's first note that g of j omega is a complex quantity and can be written as follows. Because when you are going to solve this transfer function at your frequency, let's suppose omega is equal to omega 1, you will get a complex number. It can be represented in terms of the real and the imaginary part. So the closed loop magnitude m is basically the magnitude of this part. How you are going to get that one? X square plus y square under root. So you will get the magnitude of the transfer function g of g omega. And we know that the closed loop response is given by this equation, that is g of s divided by 1 plus g of s. So here you can see that in this we are going to replace s with j omega, and we are going to find out the magnitude. So in the numerator we have the magnitude of x plus j y, and in the denominator that is 1 plus g of s. So in this we are going to replace s with j omega, so it will be a complex number, right? And the magnitude of the 1 is simply the 1. So magnitude of the denominator is 1 plus x plus jy. So the m is basically the magnitude of the closed loop transfer function, right? And what will be the m square? If you evaluate the m square, if you take the square on both sides and if you simplify, you are going to get this equation. So m square can be obtained like this. Okay, now if we do some mathematical steps, if we multiply this one on this side and simplify this one, so we can write down this equation, So further simplifying, we can write down this equation like this: m square plus 2m square into x, m square into x square, m square into y square minus x square minus y square, that will be equal to 0. And rearranging this equation, we can write down this equation, right? So now if we take m is equal to 1 in this equation, so this equation will reduce to simple this linear equation minus 2x plus 1, because if we consider m is equal to 1, this part will become 0, this will become minus 2x, this will become 0, from here we have the minus 1. So from this equation we know that x is equal to minus 1 by 2. If you want to represent it on the xy plane, so this will give you a straight line, because the x is always equal to minus 1 by 2 when m is equal to 1. That's the magnitude of your closed loop response is equal to 1, then you will get the straight line. So this is the equation of the straight line, which is parallel to the y-axis and is passing through the point minus 1 by 2, 0, right? So we have evaluated this equation for m is equal to 1. Now we will see for the other values of the m. Let's suppose that if m is not equal to 1, then we can modify this equation that we have seen earlier, and it can be written like this, dividing it by 1 minus m square. So this will become x square, and this will become 2m square divided by m square minus 1. This is swapped, that's why it has become plus. And similarly, this will become y square and minus m square divided by 1 minus m square, or m square minus 1 will make it positive. So we have this equation, and we can add, let's suppose, this term m square by m square minus 1 whole square on the both sides of this equation. So we are going to get this equation if we add this on this side as well as on this side. Okay, and after doing certain mathematical steps, you will be obtaining this equation from this one, and further you can look at that one, that this part is simplified and can be written like this. Okay, so now this equation that we have seen over here can be written like this, and finally we can write this equation in this form, because this is going to make a complete square. So x square plus m square by m square minus 1 whole square plus y square is equal to m square by m square minus 1 whole square. So this is basically the equation of the circle, because we know that a circle with the center at the origin is x square plus y square is equal to the radius square. Over here we have the displacement over the x-axis. The x coordinate of the circle is not at the zero. So the equation of the circle is like that. So from this equation we can say the center of the circle that is formed by this equation, that is equal to this one. That is the its x coordinate will be obtained from here, that is minus m square by m square minus 1, and the y coordinate of the center, that is 0, and the radius of the circle is the magnitude of this part, right? Okay, so now the constant m loci on the GS plane are thus a family of the circles, and how you are going to get those circles by taking different values of the m, because we have seen that this equation can be represented as the equation of the circle, and that we have derived for the magnitude of the closed loop response. So now if we take different values of the m, let's suppose m is equal to 1.3, then the center will come out to be minus 2.45 and the 0, and the radius will be equal to 1.88. So in this diagram you can see the circles which are plotted, and for different values of the m. So for m is equal to 1, we have already seen that there it was a straight line parallel to the y-axis, and if m is equal to, let's suppose, 1.2, you are going to get a circle, and as the magnitude is going to increase, for the m is equal to 1.3, you have this circle. For m is equal to 1.4, you will get this circle, and so on. So as the magnitude is increasing, the radius of the circle is going to become smaller and smaller. So for m is equal to 1, we have this line. For the m greater than 1, we have the circles like this. And if we have the magnitude less than 1, so you will be getting the circles for the closed loop response evaluated at one particular frequency. So if you have such a frequency that m is equal to 0.8, then you are going to get this circle. Similarly, for the magnitude of 0.6, you have this one, and the magnitude of 0.4, you have this one. So for one particular frequency, there is a certain magnitude of your closed loop response, and that is represented by a circle in the xy plane, right? Okay, so we have seen the constant phase locking, magnitude locus, by using the equation that we have derived earlier. Now we are going to look at for the phase. So the phase of the closed loop system will be the phase of this part and minus the phase of this part, right? So the angle, phase angle of the closed loop transfer function is given by this equation, right? So the phase angle is alpha, and that will be obtained by taking the tangent inverse of y by x and tangent inverse of y divided by 1 plus x, because the real part is 1 plus x over here. So the equation for the phase of the closed loop response is this one. Now let's suppose that the tangent alpha is equal to n. If we take the tangent on both sides of that one, let's suppose that is equal to n. So then we can write down this equation like that. Tangent of alpha will be equal to n. So taking tangent on this side, and now if you simplify this one using this trigonometric identity, so the n will be equal to this equation. Okay. So now we can simplify this equation further, and we can write it like this. And from this equation, we can write down this one. From here, we can write down this equation, and then we can rearrange it, and we can represent it like this. So now taking this equation and adding 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4 n square to the both sides of this equation, we can write it like this. And then we can rearrange it, and we can represent it in this form. So again, it is the equation of the circle, right? And what is the center of that circle? That is at minus 1 by 2, and from here it is 1 by 2n, and the radius of the circle will be obtained from here. So the phase equation is also the circle equation, just like the magnitude equation for the closed loop response. So now for different values of the frequencies, the x and y will change, and the circle radius and the center is going to change. So if we evaluate it for different values of the, for different frequencies, so here you can see if the alpha is equal to 20 degree, you have this circle. So for the alpha equal to 30 degree and 40 degree and so on. So here you have the circles obtained from the phase response of your phase equation of your closed loop response. Okay, so we have seen the m circles, and these are said to be the n circles. These are obtained from the phase equation, and the m circles are for the magnitude, right? So the common term that is used, m and n circles, to determine the closed loop frequency response. Okay, now let's look at this one. These are the m circles for different frequencies. For one particular frequency, the magnitude is 1.1, and the circle that is represented over here. So now if we take the polar plot of the transfer function that we have, so if we evaluate our transfer function at different frequencies, let's suppose at omega 1 we are going to get this magnitude, at omega 2 we have this magnitude, or this point, omega 3 we have this point, and so on. So over here, just observe this point. At this point, the polar plot is the tangent to this circle, tangent of the tangent to the circle whose magnitude is equal to 2, where the magnitude is equal to 2, that is the magnitude of your closed loop response, right? So what this point indicates, this point basically represents this thing. Just observe that one, that is the peak value of the magnitude, right? So on this side we have the magnitude of the closed loop response, that is g over 1 plus g, and on this side we have taken the frequency. So we are evaluating at different frequencies. At, let's suppose, omega 1 we have this one, and at omega 2 we have this point, omega 3, omega 4 and omega 5. So omega 4 is going to give you the maximum value. So the point at which your polar plot is a tangent to one particular circle, that is the magnitude, the maximum magnitude that you are going to get in the frequency response of your closed loop system. So that you can determine over here. This is the resonance point as well. If you compare it with the second order system, so it is the resonance point, you can say, because over here you are going to get the maximum amplitude, and this is the point when your polar plot is tangent to the particular circle, and in this case it is tangent to this circle. Okay, now let's look at the phase. If you determine the phase of your transfer function at different frequencies, at omega 1 this point we have, at omega 2 we have this point, and now we have the n circles. These are the circles which are obtained from the phase equation of your closed loop response that we have discussed in the previous slide. So you can see that it is going to intersect at the n circles at the different points, and here you can see at omega 1 we have this one, we have this point, we have this phase. At omega 2 the phase of your system is this one, at omega 3 it is this one, at omega 4 it is this one, and so on. So you can see the phase response of your closed loop system, unity feedback system, by looking at these ones. So this was the these n circles are useful to examine the phase response of your closed loop system, that how the phase of your closed loop unity feedback system is going to change with the change of the frequencies. Okay now we discussed about the Nichols chart. Those are basically the log magnitude versus the phase plot. So another approach to graphically portraying the frequency response characteristics is to use the log magnitude versus phase plot. So which is a plot of the logarithmic magnitude in decibels versus the phase angle for a frequency range of interest, in which we want to evaluate the response of our closed loop system. We will select a range, and then in that range of the frequencies we will be plotting the magnitude and the phase. So in the manual approach, the log magnitude versus phase plot can easily be constructed by reading the values of the log magnitude and the phase angle from the border diagram. The advantage of the log magnitude versus phase plots are that the relative stability of the closed loop system can be determined quickly and the compensation can be worked out easily. So now let's look at some examples. Let's suppose that we have this transfer function, one pole at the origin. So its sinusoidal transfer function will be given by this equation, and this can be represented in terms of magnitude and phase like this. So if we take different values of the omega, let's suppose 0, so you have the infinite gain, and the phase is minus 90 degrees. As you are going to change the omega here, you can see if the omega is approaching to infinity, your magnitude is going to become like this, and its phase is always 90 degrees. So this can be represented at log magnitude versus phase plot like that. Over here you can see at the different frequencies, at omega equal to 1 your gain is 0 dB, but your phase is 90 degrees. On this side you have the phase, here you can see minus 90 degrees, and the magnitude is on this axis, right? So for the frequency equal to 1, you are at this point, your phase is minus 90 degrees and your magnitude is 0. As the frequency is going to approach to 0, right, so the magnitude is going to approach to infinity, and as the frequency is going to approach to infinity, right, so your magnitude in the dBs, because on this axis we have the magnitude in the dBs, so that is approaching to a minus infinity, right? So this is the plot for the simple pole at the origin. Now let's take another example. Let's suppose that we have a system consisting of a one pole that is represented by that one. So sinusoidal transfer function, is like that, and if we represent in terms of the magnitude and the phase, so we can write it like that, t square omega square plus 1, and the phase of that one will be equal to minus tangent inverse of omega t by 1. The phase of this part will be 0, so 0 minus the phase of this one, so it is negative 1. Okay, so now if we look at the plot, gain in dBs over the y-axis and the phase over the x-axis, so here you can see that at the frequency equal to 0, the magnitude can be obtained from this equation. The magnitude is going to become, if this part goes to 0, so magnitude is going to become 1, and what about the phase? The phase is going to become 0. So as the frequency will change, frequency will be increasing, so the magnitude will be decreasing because it is in the denominator, and the phase will be changing accordingly. So this is the plot of this particular transfer function. Okay, now let's consider another example. Let's suppose there one pole is at the origin and the other pole is at the real axis, right? And so if we change the frequency omega in this one, so the magnitude with the increase of the with the decrease of the frequency will be becoming infinite, and with the increase of the frequency will be becoming will be approaching to minus infinity. And the phase over here, because of this, you have the constant phase of starting phase of 90 degree from here. If you consider the zero frequency point, so as the frequency will be increasing, the phase that will be contributed by this pole will be increasing, and finally you can see at the very high frequency you have the phase of minus 180 degrees. So at very low frequencies, only the pole at the zero that is contributing, and as the frequency is going to increase, so this pole is contributing in the phase, right? Okay, now we have already discussed the relative stability in one of our previous videos that can be determined with the help of this plot. And if you look at this graph over here, we have the phase, and over here we have the magnitude. So if you look at the intersection of your curve that you have obtained in this plane from the transfer function, closed loop transfer function, and if you get that one, and this intersection and its difference from the zero will give you the information of the phase margin, and this is the positive phase margin, and the positive gain margin is this one. So your system is stable if you have the graph like that. And if the graph of your system response is like that, so this is going to indicate the negative phase margin, the negative gain margin, the gain above this point, that is the this one, and the negative phase margin is represented like that. So for unstable system you will be having the plot like this, and for the stable system you will be having the plot like this. So if you plot the dB gain versus the phase, so looking at that graph you can determine the relative stability of the system. Okay, so Nicol chart are important one. These are used to determine the stability of the system and to look at different other parameters as well. So these are the charts which are available for the different frequencies. Let's suppose for one particular frequency, the unity feedback system, its magnitude is for 0.5 dB. Again, you have this circle. For 3 dB gain, you have this circle. For 12 dB gain, you have this circle, and so on. So using this chart, now let's see how we can in generic determine the stability of the system. So let's look at this example. Okay, so the question is, draw the Nichols chart of the following open loop transfer function and obtain the gain margin and the phase margin. So the open loop transfer function that is given to us is this one. One pole is at the origin, one pole is at s is equal to minus 1, and the other pole is at s is equal to minus 3. Okay, now first of all we solve it and we convert it into the sinusoidal transfer function. So we are going to replace this s with the j omega. So you can see over here all the s are replaced with the j omega, and now if we simplify this equation we will get this one. And if we do some mathematical steps, we can clearly represented in the form of the real and the imaginary part. So we are going to rationalize it. So multiplying and dividing it by this term, that is the conjugate of this part. So simplifying this one, we will be obtaining this equation. And this can be finally written like this in the real and the imaginary part form. So the real part and the imaginary part from here. So this is the sinusoidal transfer function. Okay, now we are going to evaluate this transfer function for different values of the omega. So starting from the very low value of the omega, omega is 0.01. The magnitude in the dB gain is in decibels is 30, and the phase at this frequency is minus 90 degree. So now if we increase the frequency, so here you can see the change in the magnitude and the change in the phase. Now let's take this table and we sketch the points over the Nichols chart. So at the if you look at this point, this is the magnitude in the decibels 30, and the phase is minus 90 degrees. So look at this point, this is the magnitude 30. So taking this point and over here, if you look at the minus 90 degree phase, so that is this point. So coming from here, if you move on and if you look at the magnitude is 30 dB, so you are at this point. So we are going to select first of all this point at the graph, right? Now let's take the second reading. In the second reading, we have the magnitude 10.3 and the phase is minus 97.5. so coming from here, it will be somewhere over here because the magnitude is 10.3 over here and the phase is 97.5. so considering 97.5 from here, so this is somewhere close to this point. So that you can say somewhere over here. And then the third point, that is minus 4.4 and minus 125 degree phase. So locating it over here, minus 125 will be somewhere over here. This is the vertical line for that one. And 4.4, minus 4.4. So in terms of dB, the dB gain is minus 4.4, so that point will be somewhere over here. So exactly, we can just consider that. Let's suppose that is this point. And similarly, if you look at all of these points, so you can identify it over the Nichols chart, and then you can take a curve that is passing through that one. That will be the closed loop response for the unity feedback system. Okay, so taking this plot now from this figure, we are moving to that one. We have taken all of these points, and on this axis we have the open loop dB gain, and from here we have the open loop phase. And at minus 180 degree, you know that the difference from the 0 dB line is basically going to give you the gain margin. So gain margin in this case is 22 dB, and if you look at the phase margin, the phase margin is this one, 70 degree, because this is the zero line. So we are comparing it with that one and minus 180 degree line. So the gain margin is positive, the phase margin is also positive. So it means your system is stable. The closed loop response will be the stable one. Okay, so that is shown over here at the Nichols chart. So if I conclude this video, what we have seen, we have observed the closed loop response of the unity feedback system, and we have seen it how we can determine it with the help of the open loop transfer function. If the open loop transfer function is given to us, we can find out the closed loop response of the unity feedback system. And then we have discussed the M circles. M circles are basically the circles representing the magnitude of your closed loop response, and the N circles represents the phase. Right, those are basically the circles, not the complete circles. If I go back and show you it over here, so these were the circles, these are the N circles. So these are basically for the phase, and similarly we have the circles for the magnitude. So for magnitude we have these ones, and for the phase we have these circles, right? So we have discussed the concept of the M and N circles, and then we have seen that how we can use the Nichols chart and to determine the stability of your system. In the example, we have seen how to determine the gain margin and the phase margin by taking the plots over the Nichols chart. So that's all from this video. Thank you very much.